Berwyn & Berwyn began trading in Manchester in 1886 and have been mass-production tailors ever since. If you've bought a suit from the High Street, chances are they made it.
The process begins here. You've got these big rolls. These are for Ted Baker. And basically, this is an assembly line. This is a factory. What you see are the bales are loaded into a machine here, loads and loads of fabric rolled into them. And the point is, because this is a factory, they're not cutting individual suits. They have big turnover. So these machines are laying out the fabric, layering them up, ensuring that they're all smoothly sort of positioned and ready to go into the machine itself. Mind out for the vents and the ducts. This is completely extraordinary. This machine is called the Gerber Cutter. There are three of them here in this factory, one here and then two over there. And what that does is cut through up to about 80 layers of fabric. It has a vacuum underneath it, so it's sucking in air, so all the fabric's held tight. And that means that when the blade starts to cut it in there, it won't slip. Inside that piece of machinery, in that head, is one of these. It's a razor blade, a big blade. Each one costs about 20 euros. And there's one of those in that head, and it's cutting through layers of fabric like this. Very, very deft. If you look up close, you can watch it go. It's so, so quick. And the thing I love most of all, there's one guy operating it, and he's slightly in the way. I don't want to disturb him because he's working, but underneath, sorry, can I? You have these. Look at this. These are the shears. This is old school. This is how they do it on Savile Row. But here, they have this big machine, that tiny blade that's super sharp, going like that. So once all those big rolls of fabric have been through the Gerber Cutter cutting machines, they're carefully labelled, they're piled up, they're placed in the back of a lorry here in Budapest, and they're driven 2.5 hours away to another factory where they're all sewn together, and that's in a town called, and I'll just get this right, Varsharoshnamein, which is about 15 kilometres from the border with Ukraine. And that's where I'm heading now. The scale of this place that is so mind-blowing. I was sort of imagining one enormous machine. You just put cloth in one end and magic suits come out the other end. Of course, it's not like that. The other thing that really strikes me is I remember meeting Charlie Allen, and we talked all about the jargon that's in tailoring. And it felt a bit like going to mechanics, opening the bonnet of a car. Well, this is the assembly line, where the cars are mass-produced and manufactured. It's exactly like that. All the bits are like chassis of vehicles hanging up, being taken along, something else welded to it, fused. And the thing that I really respect is the attention to detail. You'd think, mass-produced, who cares? But each person, they are paying so much attention to what they're doing. You can see that this is delicate, filigree, precise work. It's been a total eye-opener. The quality of what they produce here in Hungary, I think, is really pretty good. This is an example which happens to be on the dummy. It's a Ted Baker jacket, you know. Label doesn't really matter. This isn't about product placement. The point is that if you look at this thing, I mean, I've tried on. I think it's got a nice feel. And the detailing is kind of second to none. Tiny little pockets on the inside. One lining there, another different lining with a pattern there. Of course, the killer detail for me, the cuffs. The sign of a bespoke suit, they say, you can undo the cuffs. Well, I'm standing in a factory in Hungary, and there they are. Have a look at that. That's the sign of bespoke.
Best on me. Best on me. Best on me.
But 60 years ago, mass production meant ubiquity. And the lounge suit, like the frock coat it replaced, was starting to look just as stuffy. Suits became a byword for mediocrity, conformity, and blandness. Every inch of it the uniform of boring British commuter drones.
But what happened soon after the war is that society began to change, and change very fast. And all of a sudden, popular culture and fashion infiltrated the world of the suit. And here in London, the suits began to swing.
So to find out how suit trends were set during the 60s, I want to take in a couple of movies. Chris Breward from the Victoria and Albert Museum has a passion for menswear.
Now that, I think, is a very cool look.
It is.
That's yeah. Ocean's 11, it's 1960. What do you think the impact of a film like that would have been?
Film has enormous power, and people look to film stars, men as much as women, for cues. You know, this is an era when there aren't men's style magazines, when there's not the, you know, the discussion of men's fashion in the newspapers. So who do you look to? You look to the kind of key fashionable films of the time.
What are the stylistic hallmarks, if you like, of these suits? Yeah. That differentiate them?
Well, I think Dean Martin's suit in this clip is the key one. It's slightly iridescent fabric, a much lighter wool. It's cut much more tightly to the body. It's these very slim lapels, very narrow trousers, no pleats at the front. You can
order them once for the week. The style had little to do with traditional English tailoring. This was a look inspired by men on the streets of Naples and Rome.
It's lighter, it's sexier, I suppose. It's got sex appeal.
Hey, give me a little kiss.
Sound idea, it's constructive,
you wait right
which
there.
You can't say about many Savile Row suits, traditional Savile Row suits. They're doing the opposite. They're like armour, they're kind of, you know, covering up. They're presenting a different sort of mask to the world. The Italian suit, it's relaxed. It's about an open approach to life, and the sense of the Italian man as a fashion icon, this sense of sprezzatura, of kind of owning the street, of being relaxed in your clothes.
Is that what that means? It's a sense of sort of like, what, pizzazz, confidence?
Yeah, pizzazz, confidence. That's a very good definition. But Italian tailoring is all about that, which is very different to the more traditional notion of British tailoring. In a sense, this Ocean's 11 look, you can also see it reflected in the working class subcultures of the time. In the mod subcultures, for example. Mods, young working class men who are into an Italian lifestyle, the Italian mopeds, the coffee bars, the whole sort of Italian feel. What do you want to go with that? You want a sharp Italian style suit. It makes you look fabulous. And I think that's what's so new and so brilliant about it in the 60s. It's very, very fresh.
My second film is a little bit of a cheat. It's much newer, but I reckon the suits in it have become sartorial shorthand for the 60s.
Come on, babies, work with me, people, all right. Show me love. Great, baby, yeah!
This is a film that comes from 97. It's a big parody of Bond, of lots of stylish films that came out in the 60s. And Mike Myers is just camping it up to the, you know, to the max. That suit's ridiculous.
Well, surprisingly, somebody's done their research. I think there's a moment around 66, 67 in London where this kind of extreme form of menswear, just in a couple of streets, is outrageous. So, in that sense, it's not so far-fetched, I don't think.
Oh, behave.
Yeah. So suits like that were actually available for men in the 60s to buy, but not only that, they wore them.
A few men wore them. I think it became known as the sort of peacock style, the kind of swinging London look.
Hold that.
If you were a young man in swinging 60s in London, you bought a suit like that, what's the sort of message? What are you trying to say about you as a person?
Well, I think you're saying that you're kind of kicking against the establishment. You know, this is not a suit for the office job. This is a suit for going out to the new London clubs. It's a suit for engaging with the new street culture of London and engaging with the now. It means you're hyper-fashionable.
Psychedelic, dandified boutiques and tailors like Mr. Fish and Granny Takes a Trip launched the Peacock Revolution.
There's a sense of the kind of Edwardian or late Victorian dandy about this sort of costume, or even the Regency buck, that the period they really liked, the 60s designer, was the early 19th century, the kind of Regency dandy. There's a sort of madness about it, I think.
Nothing was off limits, and 60s designers used all sorts of unusual materials to steal the suit back from the establishment. Daddy wasn't there to take me to
the fair. It seems he doesn't care. It looks like he's wearing a curtain.
It does, but, you know, the researcher has done their work. We've a suit by Mr. Fish in the V&A's collection that's not so dissimilar. Those sorts of designers were taking furniture fabrics and turning them into suits.
It's only permissible within the middle of London and other urban centres. It loses its power and becomes rather dangerous when it moves outside of that sort of terrain. There's a lot of nervousness about the way that men are growing their hair, are turning into women, essentially.
I think it's disgusting, disgraceful, and effeminate.
I can't tell one from the other.
I think they're a load of puffs.
Do you think it was a particularly worrying time for those people because the suit, historically, is so synonymous with masculinity?
Yeah.
That to see that change, it's like, oh my God, this is, you know, everything we know and understand is being taken away from us.
Yeah, social conservatives were, you know, shaking in their shoes.
If the row of long-haired, weedy youths you pictured are British manhood 1967, then God help this country.
Things are loosening up in the 60s. Ways of being a man are shifting. So you've got the decriminalisation of homosexuality. It's a time of new freedoms. So in an interesting way, I think men's clothes reflect those broader changes in terms of fashion generally. So there's this technicolour moment when men's fashion changes from the monochrome, you get these incredibly bright colours, new textures, new inspiration, and then it goes again by, you know, 68, 69.
So very brief then.
Yeah.
Although menswear as a whole got progressively wilder and more relaxed throughout the 60s, this wasn't good news for the suit. By the 70s, the predominance of denim and casual wear made the suit look boring, pretty ugly, and strictly for formal occasions.
In the 70s, suits were for work and they were for Sundays and funerals and marriages. Nobody who was cool wore a suit. It was such, you know, if you wanted to look at a suit on Top of the Pops, you'd switch it on and you know who'd be wearing suits? Mud. The most ghastly, awful pop bands, Mud. I mean, trash. Or the Osmonds. Don't love me for fun, girl. Let me be the one, girl. Love me for a reason. Let the reason be love. Don't love me for fun.
It really was the decade that Tate forgot. People were wearing safari suits. If you think of Roger Moore, he was the worst-dressed Bond of all time. But the 70s wasn't without its suit moments. If you think of people like David Bowie or Brian Ferry, they were suit innovators, doing something different, doing something new. And I'm going to meet the man who helped them to do it.
There's a new sensation, a fabulous creation, a danceable solution to teenage revolution.
When Roxy Music first appeared in the early 70s, their entire look, including Brian Ferry's suits, was put together by designer Anthony Price.
Very good to meet you.